Okay, so before we get started on the music discussion, I just want to, for those that are new to Raising the Bar, don't know what it is, Raising the Bar is a sort of a kind of a branch or an organization that the Joseph Smith Foundation is sponsoring, where we're wanting to help people who are feeling like, I'm trying to raise the bar, I'm trying to live higher standards, find other people for friends. We have so many people that come to us and they say, well, I'm trying to listen to better music, but I'm the only one. Or I'm trying to find good friends for my kids, but I'm the only one. Or I don't watch all of the movies that everybody else is watching, but I'm the only one, and I don't know anybody like me, and I'm so lonely. And finally, we were saying, wait a minute, there's a lot of people that are telling us they're the only one. We need to get all of those people together. So the vision is we want to find people in every county across the United States that can gather. Obviously, this event is hosted by the Utah County Group. We have a group in San Pete, if you are there or know someone who is there. And then we also have a Facebook group, and we will soon have a website and a bunch of other resources. So if that is something that you're interested in and you're not already, then let us know and we can get you added into the appropriate places. Okay, we're gonna go ahead and we are going to start with the presentation tonight. Music, the Forgotten Language of the Heart. And I guess for those that don't know, this is my dad, James Stoddard. Everybody thinks he's my brother, or that we're married, because he looks so young and I guess I look so old, but he's actually my dad. And this is really, if I could just draw this way, I am so grateful for my dad and how he raised us with these standards of music, because it changed my life. And I remember being 15, I remember being 12, and going somewhere with a whole bunch of peers my age, and they were listening to music, and I was like, oh, I know I shouldn't be listening to this music, and I didn't really know why, but I knew that I shouldn't. And so I told them, I can't listen to this, and they were like, well, why? And I'm like, my dad wouldn't like it. And then I remember after that, I was like, that's a really lousy answer. I should know for myself, you know? But then as I grew older, I started to understand more why, and I can bear testimony that the principles here can change you. So if you have a teen who is struggling, or a child that is struggling of any age, music is such an important part. And part of the story probably of how my dad learned that and how I came to know that for myself, even though I was raised with this, will come out throughout the presentation. Do you want to start that?
So one thing that's so critical to understand is some people believe that they feel only the Spirit through their heart, and some people believe they feel the Spirit only through their mind. But the revelation in the Doctrine and Covenants here that we're showing says that we learn through the Spirit in our mind and our heart. And before we make any decision, we should be very careful that both our mind and our heart are in alignment. What is the heart? The heart is feeling. And it's amazing with music or words. If I was to put a bunch of graphic words up here on the screen, no one would stay here. But if I was to play something very graphic or pornographic with music,
but not with words.
Not with words, but with the music being that, we would think it was a church dance, right? So what I'm saying is we need to revolutionize our thinking on the heart and on our feelings, okay? So hopefully tonight we're going to really work hard on trying to learning to analyze music. So we do film production, we produce documentaries and other videos and different things. You'll learn a lot when you're scoring a piece of music, because if you take a piece of music and put a certain sound behind it, it makes all the difference. So tonight hopefully we're going to walk through doing that a little bit.
We are going to start by playing a music sample. We're going to be doing this throughout the presentation. And be thinking about, while we're playing it, what's the emotion that you're feeling? What is the language of this piece?
This comes from Braveheart. None of us actually have seen this. Years and years ago, I started watching it, made it a couple of minutes in and turned it off. But so don't hold that against us. But
the music's amazing.
The music's amazing. So if everybody can have a paper and a pen, and while we're walking through these music, we're going to hopefully, we'll see how far we get. We could be upwards of 17 to 20 pieces of music. I want you to think about the emotion behind this. Here's one way to look at that. What picture do you see in your mind? What picture do you see in your mind while you're listening to the music? Okay. So years ago when I taught high school, I would take all my classes through this and I would play. I'd say, okay, you guys bring in your music, I'll bring in some of my music, and we'll have you listen to that, write down what you see. Okay, so that's what you're trying to do here on the music as we place, and kind of write small because we're going to have a lot of pieces. Again, you know, it could be very noble, it could be battle, it could be whatever you see. The other thing that we're going to talk about here, and you can write down, what kind of effect do you think this would have on my body? You know, you'll notice, like, if you pull up to the stop sign, right? We've all seen this, and somebody is listening to something in a different car than your car. They can be acting very strangely by what they're watching, or not watching, but listening to. You're watching them. Okay, so the other thing is what is the emotion? What is the emotion behind the music? Is it solemn? Is it lighthearted? Is it sad? Is it happy? Fear or courage? Forthrightness, right? Anticipation or realization? Is it sloppy or proper? Is it surprise? Does it have an element of surprise, or is it predictable? Is it helpless, or is it in control? All of these things are elements of music. Every piece of music will be somewhere, and you can see we have this little scale here. So there will be some scale, and you can even rate it. And you can say, okay, what is this? Again, does the music foster despair or hope? Is it sedate or excited? Is it ordinary or does it inspire awe? Is it timid or is it confident? Okay. And again, here's another way to look at music. Is it good or bad? Not good or bad as in the composition and the composer, but just, is it light or dark? Is it pure and holy or polluted? So those are all ways to think about music, okay? So what we're going to do here for a second, we talked about this a little bit earlier, but here's what is considered, there's all these lists out there of who's the greatest film composers, right? And you, always these three are at the top of the list, right? Hans Zimmer, James Horner, John Williams, okay? These guys are masters at moving people to a certain place and helping them feel something, okay? Now, unfortunately in our society, for decades and decades and decades, we've been moved by music without ever understanding what the composers were moving us to. Okay? Hopefully tonight we're going to talk about, let's talk about what we're actually listening to and learn some of the principles behind it.
Okay, so we're going to play that piece of music again from Braveheart and be thinking of those, all of those questions. We're going to, I even have a sheet with some of those questions there that you can think about while the music is playing.
Okay, so the theme just changed there a little bit, but what did you see? What picture do you see? Does anybody want to go ahead and yell something out? Or are we timid?
This is a discussion, so.
I saw the earth, mountains, beauty.
Okay, so mountains, beauty, okay.
The sunrise.
A sunrise. Okay, excellent, thanks. Right, an eagle soaring. So these are actually very profound. You think about it. We're going to play different pieces, and you're going to see different things, okay? What emotions? What emotions now?
Peace.
Okay? Uh-huh. Yes, it definitely felt timid at the beginning, and that's interesting. Why would a composer make it timid? I think that's not too hard to figure out on that piece, but very important.
Tenderness.
Wonder. And wonder. Excellent. Thank you. Okay. So what is the setting? Could be the same thing as the picture. Did anybody, what setting do you have in your mind? Right. Sunset. Okay.
I feel like it could have been a battlefield. One side just won.
Okay. So not a battlefield fighting, but it's over and somebody won. Okay. Excellent. Thank you. So
if it was,
you're saying if it was a Book of Mormon video or movie, it'd be after the Nephites were killed off.
Right, and just the sadness.
So you're saying there's a bit of sadness in that piece.
But at the same time,
So
completely opposite kinds of things.
Uh-huh. Interesting. Now, there's a pretty good indication the composer might have wanted to do that. They're usually going to put more than one feeling at the same time, almost always. And that really is helping move the audience in different directions. Interesting, you would think they would be opposing, right? So, well, actually, that's purposefully done, right? You want to have opposition in the music so that it pulls on your emotions, to have opposition in your emotions. So that's very insightful. Yeah, okay. So, oh yeah, go ahead.
Well, when I did the first time, I thought about the failure.
Right, a boat sailing into the distance. Okay, very good. Thank you. Okay, so real quick, we'll talk really quickly here. You know, what's the personality? What effect does this music have on your body? We'll just take a couple of things really quick. All right, so in every group, you're going to get somebody to say, okay, put you to sleep, okay? And so, yeah, go ahead.
I felt drawn in. As it started off very timid, and as it got more noble, almost you just felt your heart getting drawn into it.
Okay, heart being drawn into it. Excellent, yeah. So is this uplifting? Here's a question. So would you consider this piece to be uplifting? Is this something you would play in your home to uplift or not? That's a very critical. Okay. Okay. Self-reflecting, uplifting. Okay. Right. Patriotism. Love of country. Right. Might have been slightly swayed by us telling you it was from Braveheart and you already knowing that, but actually though, maybe not, right? Yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, so we'll go ahead and go to music sample number two. This is a very different piece. These are some of the more moving pieces that are out there, you know, that people can listen to, and most every one of these you can listen to out there for free. Okay, both of these you can. They're right there on YouTube. You can play them anytime you want. What picture do you see?
The football game.
Okay.
So if you were to do a time lapse on this football game, it started out as aggression.
Right.
It became confident through success.
Right. So a football game, right. Yep. Excellent. Thank you.
Soldiers marching home after a victory.
Okay. Soldiers marching home after a victory. Yeah, go ahead. So it was kind of a battlefield commencement ceremony and rockets launching into space. Great.
When I heard the first part of the music, it just caused me to tense up. You know, the certain tones that just hit you, just tense up.
Yes.
It makes you want to stand up and brings off like a fighting soldier type of.
Right. So definitely different, right, than the piece we just were listening to before that is very peaceful. This is very tense up. You know, and very, yeah.
I thought it felt chaotic in my mind.
Chaotic.
And
but,
okay,
confusion maybe compared to some things, but still pretty ordered, would you say, or not?
Well, it was pretty ordered, but I still felt like chaos but, in my
okay.
mind.
Okay, so the music was ordered, but you're feeling chaos in your mind. Okay, thank you, yep. Okay, so in a movie, running for something from fear.
And then, maybe in a Hollywood movie. And then at the end, it was more like we won.
Okay. Right. Definitely a victory feeling behind it. Okay, we'll go really, really fast, and then go ahead.
I'm just being called to serve.
Called to serve.
Going into the mission field.
Going into the mission field. I don't know why you would feel that way, right? Yeah, go ahead. Make or break kind of a moment. Okay, thank you. Very good. So now we're going to play. This is actually, this next piece is one of my favorite pieces. It's from a movie almost nobody's ever heard about. It's called The Inheritance. It's an amazing movie. This is the most, we used to, sometimes whenever I would have, you know, a hard day or whatever, I'd just say, I got to go watch the horse race. But this really is it's a moving piece. So you're going to notice a lot of building in this piece. It'll start out and then it'll move you. What are you picturing? I'm a little biased because I've watched the movie so many times, but yeah. All right, go ahead.
I can picture like a mythical land.
So a mythical land, mythical creatures. Okay, thank you. Soldiers fighting, okay. A what? Journey. Journey. Okay? Okay?
I see somebody who's coming home from like a pioneer trek.
Coming home from a pioneer trek? Okay? Okay?
Starting off on an adventure.
I tell you, I wish I could show, and then we'll go there. I wish I could show the choreographed video that went with this, because they did probably the best job I've almost ever seen of somebody choreographing the music to the video. It was incredible. It's actually, they start out there with there's a man on one horse and a woman on the other horse, and they're, and they start out, you can see it at the beginning, they're together, and then they look down, they get a little bit competitive, and then they take off, and they're racing, and they're just gliding, and that's when you see this momentum building.
Thank you. quite the writer, Miss Adelon.
You were saying like a journey and stuff, because in the process of this minute, it's like their relationship, to give it away. It's kind of obvious from the beginning of the movie, but the relationship goes through this transformation from the beginning of the horse race to the end, and that's all in the music. So it's amazing that you haven't seen The Inheritance. So you need to see it.
Everybody needs to go watch The Inheritance. And
he's even a guy, so.
Okay, so yeah, go ahead. Right, peace, harmony, contentment. Excellent. So, okay, should we do that one later? Have we done enough that we
can?
Or the
Chronicles? I was going to say they can watch the transition. Do you want to do a pause in that way?
Yeah, that's great.
Okay,
it'll be fun.
So we're going to step this up. So not just about the what feeling do you feel, but how does the message change? Like, how does the scene change throughout the piece? So we're going to play this piece from the Chronicles of Narnia. So notice, maybe we'll probably pause it on a couple and notice, what are you feeling and how does it change and how is a story told through the piece?
How did it change? What did it change from and to? And let's see if we can get, let's go ahead and hear, and then I'm going to see if we can get people who haven't raised their hand. But
like,
I'm very proud of this.
Scary at first. It's like a thing that
right. So scary at first, and it wouldn't be. Right. And then you've got this battle ensuing, right? And kind of the good guys are coming in. The bad guys at the beginning and the good guys coming in. Okay? Yeah. Right. So definitely it starts out with darkness, then you can see the light, and then it reminds you of a battle between light and darkness. How important would that be to understand for life? Now, what if you were going to only listen to the beginning parts that were in the darkness? Okay, what kind of a life would that be? What kind of a home environment would that be? What kind of a feeling would that be if you stayed in the darkness without the light coming in? We should, you know, those are just some things to think about. Did you? Okay, so we're going to go ahead and move on.
We're going to move on.
I think so, unless people, did anybody have anything else that they wanted to say or... Okay, so now we're going to start taking this over into, so it's one thing to take pieces of everything we've played so far. Would everybody say that they were at least somewhat wholesome music overall? Right? Most people would not have too much of a problem, playing this in their home. Now we're going to head into talking about different kinds that might not be so wholesome, right? So here's a statement by President Ezra Taft Benson. He says, we seek for that which is praiseworthy, lovely, virtuous, and of good report, right? Article of Faith number 13. In due time, he's talking at BYU, he's talking about BYU, he's talking about the church. In due time, we will also have more of our own giants, particularly great patriarchs and noble companions and mothers of men. There is certain music heard and art seen and clothes worn on this campus, that's BYU, that must pass away. This is 1974. Back when they had a pretty strict dress code, back when things were much more, well, let's just say they were better than today. And he's saying there's things that need to pass away. He says, not because the styles change, okay, styles have changed a little bit. 70s, then the 80s, those were the glory days. When I grew up, when actually people lived somewhat civilized, and then we went back to the 90s, or it was going back into the 70s, right? Everybody noticed that happened? Some people disagree. So, but anyway, the styles changed, the standards will be improved. That's what we're after. Now, let me get moving here. So, in the early 90s, the very early 90s, probably 1991-ish, I was at BYU, and pretty new there. And I happened to sit down at a basketball game, back when I had time to go to a basketball game. And I looked across, straight across from me, because I was down at the bottom, and straight across from me, there was two folks that pretty much everyone in here knows. One of them was President Gordon B. Hinckley, and the other one was President Thomas S. Monson. And what was interesting is I can't remember if it was at the beginning of the game or at halftime, but the drill team did a very interesting piece, shall we say, to Janet Jackson. And it was very, shall we say, I would say vulgar, extreme, and I could say a lot of other words. So they did this performance. But not any different than probably every time that pretty much the drill team does most performances. But anyway, so they did this performance, and I looked across, because I was very interested when it got done, because everybody's clapping and cheering and whistling and on and on. I was very interested to see what Gordon B. Hinckley and Thomas S. Monson would do. And it was really interesting. So I probably wasn't the only person in there that had my eyes on those two, right? How embarrassing would it be if one of them didn't clap, would you say? That would be a noticeable thing, right? That would be a serious slight. So Gordon B. Hinckley just stood there with his arms folded like this and he didn't clap. And President Monson went like this. With about that look on his face, okay? So that was an interesting experience. I was thinking about what is the right kind of music. I didn't have any questions about that not being the right kind, but so here's another quote by President Benson. He says, youth leaders, are you holding aloft our standards? Or have you compromised them for the lowest common denominator in order to appease the deceived or vile within the church? Okay? And these quotes will be out there, and you can go read them. They're already out there. Is the music you listen to, does it have a loud beat, you know, strobe lights, darkness? And then listen to what he says here. He says, have we, as Moroni warned, polluted the Holy Church of God? So that's coming from down there at the end of the Book of Mormon. There's this phrase about how in the last days there would be a pollution of the Holy Church of God, and that's what he's quoting. And he's quoting that in relation to the kinds of music we're listening to. And then he says, the auxiliaries of the church are supposed to be a help, not a hindrance. You know, and then he says, today because some parents have refused to become informed and then stand up and inform their children they are witnessing the gradual physical and spiritual destruction of their posterity. Okay? We talked about this a while ago, earlier today, but how are things, you know? We're witnessing the greatest migration out of the church that we've ever had in the church's history. And the youth between 18 and 35 are leaving at a greater rate. It's above 50%, above 60%, above 70%, and sometimes above 80% in different areas of the church. Okay? Why is that going on? Some things to think about. Now we're going to listen to a piece that is a little bit different than those other pieces, and then we won't stay on the subject all night, don't worry. But we just wanted to play a piece for a second to get an idea.
To analyze.
So make sure you analyze this piece with the questions, and we'll see what you come up with and see how well this is.
The same on the, what's the emotion, what's the feeling, and all that, those same questions.
Out this morning and the sun was gone. Turned on some music.
Can I just pause for a second? Right there. So does anybody know what's different about this music in terms of the musical composition maybe than what we played so far? Do you hear that beat behind it? Okay, that's called a backbeat or an offbeat. And we're going to read a little bit about in a minute what Harold Bealey and President Benson said about that backbeat, but so just pay attention to that. And what's the feeling, and how is this different than maybe what we've been feeling before?
Music to start my day, then lost myself in a familiar song. I closed my eyes and I slipped away.
Okay, I'm going to stop it there. And before we talk about it, this is not an original piece. That's Jenny Oaks Baker playing the violin and then somebody else on the guitar there. This is not their original piece. It's actually a rework of a piece done in 1976 by a rock band known as the Boston. We're just going to play that for just a second so you can see. So we're not going to play too much of that, but so that's 1976. So around that same time, Harold Bealey made a statement where he talked about offbeat and backbeat was becoming very popular in that age, and he said, "The hell holes of Satan are always made very attractive. They feature enticing music of the kind that appeals to the lower senses." Now, Harold Bealey was a musician, and he in this comment, he was using a little bit of humor where he goes, "Well, there might be good rock music, but I don't know what it is." In other words, he's saying, "I'm a musician, I'm an expert on the subject, and it doesn't exist." But there's damnable rock music that appeals to the lower senses of man, where the offbeat is just as vile and abrasive to human thought as it can be. Now, most people today, 2019, they hear this comment and they're like, "Oh, we know what he's talking about. He's talking about when you pull into the intersection near a high school, right? And that car next to you is playing that music that's so loud and so you're like, oh my goodness, how can they even be in the car? Like, I can hear it with my windows closed. I'd never listen to that, right?" Well, he's not talking about that kind of music. He's talking about his time period. This quote is contemporary with the music we were just playing. So that's the kind of rock beat that he's playing with. Now, I want to talk in a second. What were some of your thoughts? What was the emotion in that piece? And why do you think that President Harold B. Lee would say that it was vile, that it was abrasive, and that it appealed to the lower senses.
Well, let's see.
Does anybody have any thoughts? This is kind of a revolutionary concept because it's different than what a lot of people talk about. Yeah.
I think to me it felt kind of like chaotic.
Okay, chaotic. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Had an icky feeling. Yep, I agree. Yeah.
That's a very profound analysis. Icky. It actually is very good. Right, so the clues from how they're acting when they're performing, right? And so the question is, we should ask ourselves, is the way they're looking, is that wholesome? Those are questions. Or is the most profound statement of the night, or is it ucky, right? Right? Yeah. Right.
The car I was riding in, he had just left the temple. And there was a 17-year-old next to me who was very steeped in the world. And I said the same thing he just said. I feel yucky. I don't like that thing, that loud thing that makes the car shake. I didn't even know what it was called.
Right.
And I'll never forget how ridiculous he made me feel because I said that.
Yep.
He said, that's base, stupid. That's what he said.
Right.
And I knew then.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that. Thanks. Yep.
The biggest thing I felt was the lack of everything I felt in the other music. There was no peace, there was no tenderness, there was no uplift.
Right. So the lack of everything of the other pieces. Right? And the opposite even. Right? Yeah, that's okay. That is so profound, right? She's saying there's part of it that's drawing you in, and then part of it of you is saying, look, I don't want to be drawn into this, right? This is so it's causing this battle. So profound. So what part of us would be drawn in by that? Right.
Not your more noble senses and feelings of the heart.
So the body and not the more noble senses. And the scriptures call that sensuality, right? Sensual. And it's interesting, look up sensual, read it in the scriptures. It's always next to devilish, which is kind of interesting. Okay, so let's just talk about quickly, here's godlike attributes, right? Godlike attributes, refined honor, conviction, no compromise with evil, sacrifice, love, joy, integrity, order, peace, long-suffering, meekness, humility, soberness, gentle, nobility, clean, compassion. Is there anybody here that would not agree that these are the attributes of godliness or some of the many, many, many attributes of godliness? And I'll tell you, I know that in the presence of God, every one of these attributes abound in fullness and many more. Okay? Now, the opposites of all those, if it's not refined, is it sloppy? If it's not honorable, is it lowliness? conviction or groveling, standing versus compromise, sacrifice versus selfishness.
I think the reason why having this comparison is important, for me, that piece and then others like it always seems to arouse that sense, the lower sense in me, of pride and arrogance. And pride and arrogance are very general terms, like you have to like get specific, but in general in that way. And but what when I talk to some people, they're like, no, like I feel confident, like okay, I feel courage, right? And it's because they're confusing what's the difference between having courage or conviction or versus pride and being arrogant, right? Satan creates counterfeits. So here's another example. A lot of modern pop love songs, and people say, oh, this is a love song, and it has that beat behind it. They're like, oh, well, when I listen to this, I just think about my boyfriend or my girlfriend, and I just love them. Okay, that feeling is not love. That feeling is lust. Love is something that's different, and Satan imitates the two. And so that's why it's so important to sit down and analyze music and say, am I really feeling courage or am I really feeling arrogance? Like, I've got the world under control and I don't care what anybody tells me to do. I'm just going to do what I'm going to do, right? Like, and try to stand in my way. Or is this like, okay, I'm going to stand for principle and I'm going to do it with meekness and I'm going to do it with humility. And I am going to go out there with compassion and love and self-sacrifice. But if someone tells me to compromise my standards, I can't. And I will stand firm, relying on God, right? Those are two completely different feelings, and the music is communicating that.
So about 12, 13 years ago, just to give you some indication of how powerful this can be, so I was coaching basketball, and I was actually coaching basketball in a Christian league, which is kind of interesting. We didn't, not every team in there was Christian, but I was coaching a Christian team, which was very interesting. It was an evangelical Christian team, and it was interesting when they found out I was Mormon. They made a new rule, because they had this rule, no Mormons can be in any leadership. They can't coach, they can't be in any leadership in any of their organizations. And so they made a new rule. They said, no Mormons can be in any leadership positions except for James Stoddard. I'm not kidding. That was right in their code. James Stoddard's okay. Everybody else says no. But so I was in this Christian league. So most of the warm-ups were actually pretty good in that league. We went to a team that wasn't in the Christian League, and we were warming up, and they were playing AC/DC and some other things at warm up. So my team, we depended a lot on them doing what I told them to do, because no offense to any of them, but they weren't very talented. So we threw every kind of press and every kind of different strategy and everything to throw at people to be able to mix up the other team. So I needed to have very good coordination between me and my team. Otherwise, we got fried a few times if that didn't happen. So we're out there. They warm up with AC/DC. And I kid you not, within a few minutes of that game starting, my team is fighting with me. They're arguing at me. They're basically, you know, it was very difficult and interesting. Learned a lot that day. So anyway, these kinds of feelings are very powerful. What you let into your home is hugely important. Okay, so, yep.
So on this next piece, now I don't know about you, but kind of the spirit from that music we were playing is still kind of hanging around. I don't know if anybody else is feeling that, but it's kind of still in there. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna bring in a good piece, and we were listening to a piece that I would say suggests a lot of pride and a lot of arrogance. We're gonna play a good piece, that we feel is good, that has the good version, the opposite of that. Courage, heroism, conviction, and we're gonna play that. Notice the difference, and we'll have the questions up there on the screen.
We'll be right back.
So what do you think? Is this, how would you compare it to the other P's? Yeah, go ahead.
So when you guys said you were going to turn it on, I could feel like I could just sit up and be enlightened, that I was about to feel the spirit again, and just felt good.
So you can, it makes you feel good again. Thank you. Yeah, go ahead.
When I listen to the bad music, I tense up, and then when I listen to the good music, I relax.
Right. So the one music makes you tense up. This is relaxed, so that's good, right? But was the music sedate? Or was it pretty lively? Pretty lively. So it wasn't because it wasn't lively, then it had to be something else that was causing you to tense up a little bit on the other stuff, maybe, right? Something to think about. So other things real quick, thoughts?
Oh, no!
Okay.
One of the things that I've noticed about different classes of music is that piece that you just played is compelling and requires a person to engage with the music. One of the things that happens with the bass 4/4 beat and the heartbeats that happens is it actually impacts our senses and deadens our senses. It doesn't require a person to engage, which opens the trap for the lyrics to get laced into so many songs that one could argue are actually more of a pervasive problem than the beat and the other stuff.
Mm-hmm. So that could be a discussion, right? What's more powerful, the music or the words?
Well, I don't think you could pick one of them.
Right. And the combination is going to be more powerful than the two. Yeah, excellent. Go ahead.
It's interesting when I've talked to people about the previous piece that you just did versus the one I had before,
right,
before the last one.
The Jenny Oaks Baker. Right.
I need that type of music to make me move and get going in the
right
morning and all this kind of thing. Whereas it's interesting that last piece you did, that makes me want to get up and move.
Right.
Without the backbeat.
Right.
The backbeat is still gives you a yucky feeling. No matter what you say.
So, the profound statement from the front. Yeah, right? So one thing that's super interesting about music is some music drives you and takes over. Other music keeps your mind in control. And that's an interesting thing. If everybody could think about that for a second. What I'm saying is rock music is designed in such a way to have the heart or the emotions take over the mind. Whereas the Zion's Camp piece there, that's what it's called, is meant to keep the mind in control of the body. And that, yeah, go ahead. Right. Excellent. Yes, much better said. So he said it's not really the mind in control as much as in order or being or keeping it in order, right? So that actually, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So this is an important thing. Should we have our emotions take over our mind or our mind always control our emotions? And I'll tell you, that actually plays a large part in family order, men and women and differences, and all kinds of other things that are way beyond this presentation. But those are things you can study and different things. We talk about that another time. If I spring it up, it'll take me 3 hours to... Okay. So, do you want to go ahead and talk about it? Or shall I can do it? So, okay. So, this is an apocryphal piece. It's called The Second Book of Adam and Eve. And it's very profound and interesting.